known man during his day. And he was a blessed man, feared God, famous by his integrity, sincerity, and kindness. And I'm just kind of reading the story. His world began to collapse all of a sudden. One day, he was crushed with a number of sudden and overwhelming reverses and calamities which stunned all of the known world. His vast herds of camel and oxygen were suddenly, stolen? Y'all knew that. All of his herd, the big herd of camels and oxen, were suddenly stolen. Right. His vast herd of sheep were killed with all of his servants. At the same time, his family of 10 children were all killed by a cyclone. That's enough to destroy anybody. To add to his misfortune, Job himself was smitten with the most hideous and painful disease known as some type of leprosy. And Job's disease caused his flesh to be covered with worms, and the infection issuing from his sores caused his clothes to stick to his body. His bones became black and inflamed with a burning heat. His physical deterioration became so rapid until he dwindled to a shadow of what he was in the prime of life. Job was distressed and broken on every side. He wished he had never been born, and he longed to die. Now, add bad matters worse. His friends attribute his calamity to some vile and terrible sin that he wasn't guilty of. And then everybody around him began to scorn and show contempt to him. He began to gossip about him. Little children poke fun at him. Thugs on the street mocked him and spat in his face. And those who were of his rank and those that held him in high esteem, they hated him, looked upon him with disrespect and disgrace. Finally, his wife deserted him and suggested that he curse God and die. Now, when your wife turns against you, your family, amen, you probably ready to throw in the towel. Job, formerly a man of honor, known for his honesty and integrity and a good name, became only a fleeting memory in the minds and hearts of those who once loved and admired him. Now, why did all of this happen to such a good man? That's a good question. Anybody know why all this happened to Job? All right. Job said he feared that something would happen to his sons. Job 1:5. Satan needs only a little space to enter in. If you are continually scared, worried, and in fear, you will talk about it like Job did. So this is something that you want to take note of. If you're really scared about something, if you're fearful of anything that's going to be happening to you, if you get fearful of something that you're imagining or you're contemplating and you're thinking about something, if you are continually scared, worried, and in fear, you will talk about it like Job did. If you say it with your mouth and believe it in your heart, you will have it in your life. I mean, this is true. Job talked fear, expected the worst, and got the fruit of it. Unbelief and doubt will bring down the hedge, pull back the angels, and leave you without protection. And there's a scripture which says, "He that diggeth a pit shall fall into it. Whoso breaketh an hedge, a serpent shall bite him." Amen. So all of that happened to Job, but yet Job didn't see where he had missed God. So finally, God had to show him. Let me just show you something that perhaps you have never seen before about Job's condition. But this is showing you the mercy of God, how far extended God's mercy is. Job 13:15. Job, who was supposed to be wise, said many things ignorantly, not being clear of God's or Satan's role in his plight. Job's ignorance and arrogance came through very clear in the classic passage found in Job 13:15. All right, we've heard this, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. How many have heard that before? Though he slay me, yet will I what? Okay, so Job was ignorant of what God did and what Satan. I mean, there was a lot of ignorance in there too. But the laws, spiritual laws still work. Natural laws still work whether you're ignorant of them or whether you are acquainted with them. That's the bad thing about ignorance. Some people say, what you don't know won't hurt you, big baby. That is not a good statement. Being ignorant of a spiritual law or a natural law will what? Will really hurt you big time. All right, so this is what he said. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him, but I will maintain mine own ways before him. In other words, when Job seemed to have implied here was, I'm going to trust God, but I'm going to do my own thing too. In other words, he would do it his way and his way alone. Amen. That was one of the things that really worked against Job big time, because he was, you know, headed up like a cabbage. All right, so he didn't get humble until God called him in judgment, when he told God, God, let's meet in court, because I want to settle the score. I want to prove that I'm right and everybody else is wrong. Even you're wrong, God. So he was big-headed. I mean, he was really puffed up with pride. But when God got him in court and set him on the stand there, began to direct all of these questions to him, he wasn't even able to answer even a single one. And then he realized how lanky, lean, and lacking he was. He finally, amen, repented in sackcloth and ashes. Amen. Now, let me just show you how this ties into James 5, Job's affliction. The Bible speaks about James 5, verses 11 through 13. James 5, verses 11 through 13. So anytime you magnify God's mercies and compassion, it really warms people's heart and it really sets the stage for them to catch hold by faith. Okay, James 5, verse 11, it says, behold, we count, let's look at verse 10. Take my brethren, the prophets who have spoken in the name of the Lord, for an example of suffering, affliction, and of patience. Behold, we count them what? Happy, which what? Endure. Ye have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of what? Tender mercy. In other words, when God, at the end of all of Job's trouble, God stepped in and he showed himself what? Strong. He came in and he showed Job the mercy that he needed. Is that good? Amen. Praise God. So now, when you tell a story like that and show how God come through, you think that will inspire somebody else that's going through the same thing to hold on and hang in there, even though maybe they are to blame for their dilemma? But God is yet what? He's merciful. Amen. Regardless of what law you violated, what you've done that have dishonored him, God still will show you the mercy that you need when you actually, amen, open the door for God to release that mercy into your life. Amen. Praise God. Now, I just wanted to show you the passages of scriptures that you can use to really get a real powerful background and really help to build your faith in the area of God's love and God's compassion. Amen. So the case of Job is a typical example of God's love and God's compassion. You can't hardly get it any better than that. Amen. Now, I'm just about done, but Sunday, I mentioned about in Isaiah 18, I believe, about that was God's love and compassion demonstrated in the Old Covenant. But what did we say about God's compassion today? Isaiah, I believe it was 30:18 through 20, if I'm not mistaken. Since we have experienced grace and peace, which is multiplied through Christ, therefore God's ability, I love this, God's ability to show mercy and to release grace into our life today is much more powerful than it was under the Old Covenant. So that's the reason why under the New Covenant, the Bible says that grace and peace, the law was given by Moses, but grace and peace came through who? Christ. There's a lot more compassion to be received today under grace and truth than it was under the law, the Old Covenant. So that should motivate us and inspire us to place ourselves in a position where God's grace can be what? Released. Amen. In a much fuller measure than it was released even under the Old Covenant. Amen. Because God didn't hold back anything. When he sent Jesus, he pulled out all of the stops. Is that right? He pulled out what? All of the stops. Amen. He said that by not withholding Jesus, then Scripture says, God didn't withhold his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not what? With him, what? Freely give us all things. So under the new covenant, everything is given what? Freely. I mean, there's no end. Bible says, I haven't seen neither what? Amen. Amen. So we just need a bigger revelation. Amen. Because the skies are no what? No limit. Scripture says he has given us and blessed us with what? Every spiritual blessing in what? Heavenly. It's not by measure. I mean, it's according to his what? Riches and glory through who? Christ Jesus. Amen. It's under the new covenant. Amen. God is what? Rich in what? Mercy. And let's look at that 18. And therefore will the Lord wait that he may be gracious unto you, and therefore will he be exalted. What the new covenant did is exalted Christ and placed Christ in a position where God, where he can do a lot more through us through his what? A spirit. See, through the Holy Spirit, amen, Christ is able to do much more than he was limited, amen, to do under the old covenant. Because under the old covenant, he would have to what? Find somebody to what? Amen. That would be a prophet, somebody that would communicate it. Amen. And sometimes everybody got into sin. Then he didn't have nobody to work through. Amen. But under the old covenant, amen, he has what? Made every person that have received Christ and been filled with the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, these signs shall what? Follow them that what? Believe. I mean, he's opened up the avenue of blessings, amen, without limitation. Under the new covenant. Hey, somebody say you can have whatever you say. Amen. All things are yours. You can go as high in God as you want. Is that right? You can hardly be as blessed, amen, to whatever degree that you can imagine. Amen. Every good and every perfect gift, amen, is from above, and God is willing to release those provisions in great profusion. Amen. That's possible through the new covenant because we have the life of God, we have the Holy Spirit, and we have a revelation of God's provision, amen, for us under the new covenant. So we are definitely blessed, amen, under the new covenant. Now let's look at that he may be gracious unto you, and therefore will he be exalted, that he may have mercy upon you. For the Lord is God of judgment. Blessed are they that wait for him. For the people shall dwell in Zion at Jerusalem. Thou shalt weep no more. He will be very gracious unto thee. Amen. We just read, he was gracious. He was gracious, full of compassion. But this scripture says, when God is exalted, being our compassionate, faithful high priest at the right hand of God daily, he ever living, making intercession for us, then God can bless us without limit because he's right there at the right hand of God, making those provisions and blessings as we pray. Amen. He will be very, everybody say, he will be very gracious.
Very gracious.
Everybody just say, he's very gracious now.
Very gracious.
He's not just gracious, but he's what? Very gracious, because the limits have been what? Taken out of the way. The barriers have been what? Removed. Amen. Receiving the Holy Ghost, bro, that's God on the inside of you. How many believe that that's the exceeding greatness of his power? Amen. That's the totality of all of God's power and ability working mightily within us. Amen. I want to ask a question tonight, praise God. What do you feel are some of the greatest hindrances and barriers, amen, since we have an unlimited range of provisions to draw from, and God has opened up the floodgates of blessings? He ain't held back nothing. Amen. All things are ours. Amen. I just want you to just give your take on why do you think that even in a day when the provisions and blessings are without limit, amen, it seems like the actual reception of those blessings are at a minimum in the kingdom of God. What do you feel that we could do to turn things around, amen, and take advantage of all of these blessings that God has fully, the Bible says he has richly, he gives us richly all things to what? To enjoy. All right, who wants to just take a stab at that? Because whatever it is, I want to start doing it. If I can experience more, if more is for me, if I know what to do, amen, I believe I can change some things or do some things different. Amen, praise God, I'll put more into it or whatever in order to experience more. Okay, let's try to get at the root of this problem right now. Just about 5 minutes, 5 or 10 minutes. Amen, anybody. All right, take the question again. Okay, what can we do, amen, realizing that God is gracious, but under the new covenant, he is what? Very gracious. In other words, all the stops have been what? What can we do to tap into God's rich resources? Amen. Certainly, there are some things that we can do to really make this thing more vital to us. Yeah, it is a good question. To be honest, it is a good question. I want some response to that good question. What can we do?
Determine what are the necessary ingredients to attain that. And I think so many times we've heard the scripture over and over and over and over and over again, and when you started, we can finish it with you. But then when it comes to implementing, it's like, well, you know, I know that, but and I think I would say goals. Mm-hmm. And when you establish the goals and setting the plans and learning how to integrate what the scripture says, mm-hmm, with our goals.
Mm-hmm.
So mine is goals.
Goals. All right, Derek, you want to say something?
I was going to say, Herman Cain said something about that today.
Don't bring up Herman Cain.
Don't put me in the category with Herman Cain. Give me somebody else.
All right. Come on. I got something if y'all don't, but I'm going to let y'all go first.
Once we established the goals and lay out our plans, I don't care what it is, we're always going to encounter some obstacles mm-hmm. in terms of reaching it. And I think just like the example you gave with Job, mm-hmm. when we often encounter the obstacles and sometimes the pain of getting there mm-hmm. is so excruciating, we'll say, you know, is it worth it? You know, I don't, you know, let's... Maybe I'll go to something else. Mm-hmm. It's the lack of tenacity to stay with that thing. Mm-hmm. You know, and just to stay with it and said, I know God has promises to me. He's given me a vehicle. It's difficult, but I'm going to stay with it mm-hmm. Until I accomplish this. Because pain is uncomfortable, and often we, you know, succumb to the pain. Mm-hmm. You know, just like Job did. But he came out victorious once he acknowledged whatever. But I think that's a big, big hindrance. The pain that we experience in terms of attaining our goals. And those goals could be career goals. It could be spiritual goals. They could be going on a diet or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. That's the pain of it.
In conjunction with that, I would like to say, I think, too, that oftentimes we have to take it in consideration. I think that we're lazy sometimes, and I don't know. But and then we're creatures of habit. Sometimes when we stay in our comfort zone, we begin to lull ourselves into a doldrum that we just don't do anything. And it's kind of like this morning I was talking to Tia about. I said, Tia, give me some words. I need some motivation, some encouragement. And she said something. I said, no, you got to say. And so, but she said, I was walking out the door. It was about 5:00 in the morning. And so I said, I need something to get me motivated. But I told her, I said, we're talking about the flea, and I was saying how the flea has the ability to vertical jump 6 feet high. But if you put a flea in a jar, put the cap on it, he'll jump up a few times, but he bumps his head so many times, after a while you can take the top off. Even though he has the ability to jump up and be free, he won't do it because he's tried so much. And I think sometimes in Christendom that we hear about the things and we don't really experience it because we try to do something and because it didn't work the first time, We try again, and then after a while we get discouraged because we can look back in our lives, all of us, when we were younger. How many of you know you had big dreams and big ideas of what you wanted to do with your life? Then you got a little bit older, and then maybe the money didn't compensate with your dreams. Then you know, maybe I didn't have that dream. Then before you know it, you're not even living your dreams or nothing you really wanted in life. So I think that when you look at that, when you look at the Word of God, what the Word of God says we can have, I think we've been somewhat brainwashed, and then we've hit our head so much, we begin to believe that we can't do it. But I believe if we step out of the realm of the norm, our comfort zone, I believe we begin to see those things which we never saw before. So I think it has to do with that. Just bumping our head so much and just giving up and saying, well, I guess this is not for me. You have the pain of it. Anybody else?
My thoughts were, though, even if you didn't have a goal, kind of piggyback on. Yeah, the hill said. Even if you didn't have a goal, I think sometimes of just daily activity or encounter, and I go with me first, and then, well, I guess that's the pain above my head. But it don't have a set goal or anything, just daily things that you encounter and then realize, oh, but where it said, da da da, whatever it is about that, and it simplified the whole matter. Mm-hmm. Or if, you know, even in my job or something, and I've got to come up with a conclusion, a resolution on something, and then I think, Lord, give me something, and, you know, then I go back to the Word. And so I think sometimes we don't keep ourselves in a place that we are conscious. We make a concerted effort to be aware of what we have available to us. Mm-hmm. You know, the Word, we hear it, mm-hmm. but it's that application of the simple stuff. So mm-hmm. it's real simple.
That's good.
We go off on a tangent, and mm-hmm. it was up there all the time. If we had been kind of conscious of that, probably if we got up praying and reading mm-hmm. the Word and stuff mm-hmm. like that, in terms of the scriptures, you've always admonished us to pray the Word. And I think coupled with praying the Word, I'm looking at these Jehovah names. Mm-hmm. And when we say that, I think for me, it really helps that when I say, okay, in prayer, or maybe just walking around, the Lord is my peace. And it helps me to think of a time when I may have been a little disturbed about something, and when he was really my peace. And then, the Lord is my shepherd. When maybe I needed some direction, and he just provided that. That's, to me, making the Word reality in my life. You know, it's bringing it where I can, okay, bringing home and where I can really understand it and grasp what that's really saying. Yes, knowing the scriptures where you can say it, you know, say the scriptures, but make it more than just saying it. Make it integrated, make it a part of your life. And when I do that, it becomes more real to me. Mm-hmm. I don't know mm-hmm. for other people, but for me.
All right, now we got some athletes back there. Come here. Okay, now these fellows, the level of that confidence now calls them to do all these touchdowns in every game. Yes. Okay. Now suppose they continue through elementary school, you all get elementary school, high school. Y'all come up here. Amen. And now all of the NFL players, there's something about them in terms of their confidence and their ability to okay. Now, if they could, when they follow through in their elementary, high school, college, and they become NBA players, or NFL players, okay, now, what kind of attitude do you think they will have in terms of being positive or being a mastery, their thinking, and their ability to enjoy the full range of God's blessings? How do you think that their attitude towards these things, or their ability to bring these things, make these things reality? You think your attitude would be, yeah, I can do anything, I can master, can't nobody hold me back, man, I'm gonna have everything I want. Okay, now is that the kind of attitude y'all have now? Okay, y'all talk about it. Because see, if with their persistence, they will actually be able to experience all that we're trying to talk about tonight, but they will have to stick with it. They will have to go through a lot of changes, and they can kind of tell you a little bit more, okay.
How often do you all miss practice? How often do you miss football practice?
No. Okay, another thing too, do y'all enjoy practice?
No.
Y'all enjoy going? You hate to go or you like to go?
Sometimes.
Most times,
okay. What keeps you going to practice when you really don't want to go?
Trying to play.
What?
Trying to start.
Trying to start.
What do you mean trying to start?
Like being the first one on the field.
Okay.
All right. Now, what does those touchdowns? How did it make you feel? When you run a touchdown now when you tackle somebody and keep them from making a touchdown, how does that make you feel? Huh? All right, so then happy, how does that affect you when you get real happy about your accomplishment during a game? How do you feel? How does that affect your confidence?
Well, it brings it up.
How do you feel compared? You feel like you're up to the other guys, or you feel like you could deal with anybody that you contend with?
Pretty much.
Mm-hmm. All right. All right, they're trying to be a shy on us, huh? But we're trying to come up with some examples. Now, another example I had is that a person that starts a business, Sister Denise is a good example. I'll let y'all go, but y'all come up with some more answers and we'll have you back up. Sister Denise started a business. Anybody start a business and go through all the ups and downs and stick with it, and the only reason why she got out of it is because of her health, but the Lord is really helping her to get back on track. Anybody that goes through anything that involves challenges and crises, and you hang in, you pray, you ask God's direction, and you stay in the Word, and you overcome all of those barriers and hindrances, it just makes them a different kind of believer than just the average believer. Is that right? Amen. Aren't you much stronger, and your confidence, and how you feel about yourself, all of that is much greater now since you have accomplished a lot through your business? Right. You don't feel like you're a failure. Right. Right. You live your dream.
And I was good at it.
You were.
I'm not trying to be arrogant or anything like that. I know that I was good at it, and the Lord blessed me. But yes, it was a dream one day, and I did accomplish that dream. Mm-hmm. It was hard work, but I just, and we said earlier, Pastor, that sometimes we get. Mm-hmm. Sometimes God allows us to go through things because we don't adhere to when the Holy Spirit is dealing with us. And I knew that something was going on in my body physically, but I did not stop and take time to get it checked out. I just continued thinking I was superwoman. But God never puts anything on us without allowing us to hear His voice first. So
that's good.
I really believe that I'm not a failure.
One time she was making a whole lot of money, and God is going to give her that grace again. But I think everybody ought to involve yourself in something long enough, go through the ups and downs, the ins and outs, trust in God, believe in God, until that thing really come into fruition. If you can really see the end results of something that you have started, and that you hung in there, that you had all types of difficulties and frustrations and anxiety, but you didn't give in, you didn't give up, you stayed with the Word, you stayed in prayer, and you trusted God, and you came out victorious. And as a result of that, your life has, amen, been accelerated to a higher level. I think everybody ought to go through some type of business or something and just try to, amen, and just hang in there until that business becomes very profitable, until you really become successful. Of course, that's a lot of hard work, isn't it? Amen. But we're going to have to go through something and stick with it and hang with it and become successful before we can really understand that God is a God that's always what? Touched with the things that we're going through. And when we can really experience it firsthand, it's going to put a joy, it's going to put a conviction in you, and it's going to be something that nothing you will confront will ever, amen, prevent you from, from overcoming. I think for the most part we did. So I would like to see everybody, amen, get involved in something, maybe a business, maybe like Sister Denise, it might be a multi-level marketing thing, and become a millionaire. When you become a millionaire, you overcome what? All what? A whole bunch of things. And once you have seen God's grace and mercy work so many times, He's just going to put you on a higher what? Plane. And you're going to what? is going to become reality, and the word of God will become the joy and the rejoicing of your heart. Amen. Amen. So let's say praise the Lord. All right. Well, God bless you. Let's all stand. Appreciate you coming tonight. And we were just trying to plug some of those holes for those that hadn't been in most of the sessions or quite a few of the sessions, and we just wanted to make sure that we did that before we went further, and we just gave you those points tonight. Amen. Now may the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can think or ask, according to the power that worketh in us, God be glorified. In Jesus' name, everybody said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen.